hands. So actually what we'll do is I'll start right from my very left. Are you always on the left, Jeff? Oh, I shouldn't say that. Jeff Melanson, he is the new CEO of the Toronto Symphony. He'll be talking in terms of Barry's work about the relationship between a boundless imagination and the limits of physical resources. Next is the great photographer, world-renowned photographer, Ed Burtynsky, who's put into images a lot of the stuff that Barry's put into words. In his oil series, in the films Manufactured Landscapes and Watermarks, and his overall number of exhibitions on industrial landscapes. Next on Ed's right is Elle Flanders, who with her partner Tamira Sawatsky is with Public Studio, founded Public Studio, and she may turn tonight's ideas a bit on its head and talk about cultural production as energy. And then finally, by no means least, we're going to have Jesika Briones, a passionate advocate for renewable energy. And she's the manager, business development at the Advanced Energy Center at the MARS. And she's interested in the connection between energy resources and our individual value systems. So all of these guests and these cultural activists are going to add their own layer, another layer, their own interpretation of Barry's work and the connections between art and energy. But we shouldn't wait any longer. So let me introduce the author of the book at the center of the events tonight, Barry Lord. He's going to talk about his book, Art and Energy.
Thanks, John, for a great introduction. And thanks to Kelvin Brown and the Gardiner for hosting us here tonight. You know, the slogan here is love clay. And if you think about it, wouldn't it be a little strange if, say, the AGO had a slogan like love paintings? It'd be a little strange, right? But love clay, we have no problem with. Why is that? Because clay is a product of the firecrafts. The firecrafts are all rooted in our mastery of fire, which is our very first energy source, and it brought with it the culture of the hearth, the culture of community, which made us uniquely human. And the warmth of that community, of that sense of the hearth, is what we see every time we see ceramics. It's why we always feel a certain warmth and why the gardener can get away with a slogan like, love clay. Yeah. Everyone can love clay, yes indeed. Yeah, Kelvin will not let it rest. right. Now, I wanted to start with a very brief reading from the book, because everybody likes a little bit of reading. This is the very first paragraph of the prologue. I grew up with coal. A truck poured it down a chute, poked through the basement window of our house. I shoveled it into the furnace in the middle of our cellar. After shaking the ashes from the grates, I shoveled them into a bucket and hauled it out to be taken away. I didn't have to be told that coal brought a work ethic with it. Now, some of you, I see Harry Malcolmson there, for example, some of you, certainly like me, come from the coal generation. A great many of you, most of you in fact, come from oil and gas. That is to say, the time, the last 50 years, in which oil and gas has replaced coal as the primary source of energy. We all know that all life depends on energy, but very few people have actually built on that. It means, of course, that all human life depends on energy, and that means that all of our cultures depend on the energy sources that make them possible. And make them possible means that you can't have your culture without the energy source. Now, we all know that, but we don't too often admit it to ourselves and then think, what does it mean? Because energy sources are not neutral. You think you just flip a switch, and oh, there's the energy. You flip a switch and it's off. But in fact, the energy comes from somewhere, and we're now acutely conscious that it comes from somewhere, and the and where that where it comes from brings with it a certain way of being, a certain way of life. And because it's so crucial to our cultures, to our very cultures, it determines really who we think we are. Because we can't be who we think we are without being in our culture. And our culture is dependent on that energy source, and it obliges us to accept, not necessarily to approve, but to accept certain fundamental values that come with it. Now, as John said, we don't have time to do the whole book. It does start with the mastery of fire, and it goes through the entire anthropology and history of the world in 280 pages. But it reviews both the natural and the social sources of energy. Social sources are the ways we organize ourselves in order to get better, more effective use of our energy, in order to make our energy do more. Cooperation is almost as old as the mastery of fire as a fundamental source of energy in that sense, of a social source of energy. And so is slavery. Slavery as an energy source is a whole different way of understanding slavery. The slave trade was an energy industry. It's really important to see it that way and to see that the evaluation of slavery has everything to do with its efficiency as an energy source. Now, all those ancient values, positive and negative, it's the culture of domination, of course, that comes with slavery. The culture of collective identity that comes with cooperation is very much a two-edged sword. Collective identity, yes, we're the ones who are cooperating, but I don't know about them over there. Yeah? So immediately, you get the whole business of collective identity with leadership, with differentiation between groups, and of course, eventually nationalism and so on. So all those ancient energy sources are still with us because we're still using them, as long as they're still around, and unfortunately even slavery is still with us. As long as they're still around, those cultural values are still there. They're still important, no question. But in the time we have here today, I want to deal with the current cultural, the current energy situation, the current so-called energy debate, which is really, I submit, a conflict of cultures. So here we are in the Crystal Palace. 1851 was the date of the Great Exhibition in London. Joseph Paxton, the architect, put together 230,000 panes of glass held together by cast iron. And of course, what this is, it's an application, of course, of his technique of building prefabricated greenhouses, but it was on an enormous scale, and of course, it anticipates the entire world of steel and glass that came after it, including all the exhibition pavilions that came after it. 6.2 million visitors saw this exhibition. It was the beginning of cultural tourism. People came from all over Europe, as well as throughout Britain, and they were brought there in Britain on trains, on the railways that were dependent on coal and steam and the Industrial Revolution. What was to be seen here in this first of the world's fairs were, of course, objects of natural wonder, nature's wonder, but more importantly, objects of man-made wonder, products, the products of the culture of production. And that is what coal brought with it, the whole culture of mass production on such a mass scale. And that's what this incredible prefabricated building erected in 3 months was able to do. Now, as I said, the values that come with each energy source, of course, bring with them values that constitute how we see ourselves. And one of the central values of coal, as in my the slight quotation from the book, is a reference to the work ethic. because the only way you can get coal as an energy source effectively is, first of all, enormous investment in infrastructure, but then really you have to master a disciplined workforce. And of course, the whole of the class struggle of the beginning in the 18th and through the 19th and 20th centuries, the whole of the class struggle, not just in the mines, of course, but in all the factories dependent on steam, on steam power, all of that arises from the relationship of coal as an energy source, the culture of production that makes us see ourselves as defined in relation to the struggle for production. The production process, and of course Marx and Engels wrote it, but they hardly needed to by that time, because by the 1850s, when this painting was done, it's in the Manchester City Art Gallery, it of course was evident to everybody that everything had changed. We were no longer either peasants or landowners defined in relation to the only source of wealth, which had been land. Now, the source of wealth was control over production, and everybody was now defined in relation to the struggle for for production. And this is a painting which I think really, by the way, all the illustrations here are taken from the book, so I'm stringing together the pieces from the book. This is one of my favorites from this period. This is Manet in 1873, a painting called The Railway. It's in Washington at the National Gallery of Art. Here you see the complete contrast is what, of course, Manet is interested in the background, down in a ravine. It was in the backyard of a friend of his. He sees the steam from the railway. And of course, in the foreground, we have a complete contrast of this very pretty little girl in her Sunday best, and his favorite model, Victorine Meurent. You'll recognize her from Déjeuner sur l'herbe. Victorine Meurent is looking up from her book, and what word would you use to describe the expression on her face? The word that comes to my mind is a look of alienation. Because what Manet is interested in is the contrast, precisely the contrast. Are we satisfied with ourselves, with defining ourselves in relation to the production process? Is that what really defines us, that we are either workers or capitalists or someone in the middle trying to decide what to do about it? Are we ready to accept defining ourselves in this way, with all the class consciousness that came with it, and that was at such a high point at this level when Manet is painting this? Or is there something else about us as human beings that we're somewhat alienated from the production process that is not satisfied by this? So in the next few slides, I want to follow two lines of development. One is the cultural transformation that came with electrification, and the other is that, if you just remember the look on the face of Victorine Meurent, we'll come back to that in terms of the culture of alienation, which is two parallel stories that take place during the same historical period. This is, of course, Gustav Eiffel's Tower of 1889, actually as it looks today, even more lit up than it was then. But of course, this is just done 10 years after Edison perfects the first successful electric light bulb, which far more than the glow of a gas lamp, the electric light bulb changes night into day. If we can change night into day, what can't we change? Electrification, which is of course an application of energy, electrification has been convincing us for about 135 years now that it's possible to change the world. And of course, it starts around the 1880s. The light bulb was 79. This is 89. This is the electric elevator, one of the first applications. It tells us we can live anywhere. We can live as high as these buildings all around us in Toronto. All the condos in Toronto came out of that discovery, which is announced here in, again, the Paris World's Fair. So again, you see how the World's Fairs, as in London and now in Paris, they are announcing these changes, because they're really announcing to everybody that people are different from what they were before. This is going far beyond what the culture of production was. This is telling you that you could be a change agent. You could be, you could make change. And of course, there are, in the book, I go through the successive waves, the invention of appliances for the home, for the factory, for the office, that changed women's lives totally, especially women's lives. Everybody's life, but especially women's lives. The invention of the cinema, radio and television, all of that which changed the way we communicate and entertainment, and how we discovered other parts of the world. Air conditioning, still today, one of the great challenges at the present moment in the energy debate right now is air conditioning for all those cities of the global south that need it if they're going to come anywhere close to the level of, to the economic and social level that Singapore has attained. Yeah? So that's still very much on the agenda. But if we can change the climate, what can't we change? We can change everything. And IT, digitization in our own time, it keeps telling us the same thing. It's changed the way we work. It's changed the way we meet each other. It's changed virtually every aspect of our life, and we are totally dependent on it. Notice how quickly the dependence builds up. I mean, we just turned around and all of a sudden, whoa, there's a computer failure. Oh, you know, it's all over. Our culture is gone. Yeah? So, you know, that's really, it shows us how the energy source is so linked in to what our culture can be. And here is the beginning of the grid. This is the line that went from Niagara Falls, New York to Buffalo. It was the first transmission of alternating current, thanks to Nikola Tesla, the brilliant engineer, who now has a car named after him, an energy-saving car for that reason. But it's the beginning, of course, of the grid, which is taking electrification all around the world. But as we're looking at this beginning of the grid, which is so much with us today, let's remember that electrification is what you might call a trickster. It's a bit strange because, on the one hand, of course, it was based in hydroelectric energy. That's why this line started at Niagara Falls, right? But, in fact, today, only about 15% of the world's electrical energy is coming from hydroelectric. The other 85% is coming from coal, from gas. Oil is too expensive right now, but it's coming from coal or from gas or from nuclear. Yeah? So I say it's a trickster in the sense that, yeah, you flip the switch, you got your electricity, and you may think that it's hydroelectric, but in fact, it really is bringing in those other energy sources and all their values. Those values are coming with you, right? However, what electrification is clearly about is the culture of transformation, the confidence in the ability to change the world. Lenin, of course, recognized this. One of the many ways in which the whole of the 20th century, I find it amazing that more historians don't ask this kind of question. How come in the 20th century, for the first time in history, millions and millions of people believed that it was possible to change the world? Yeah? How come? You know, it's just amazing when you think of it. And, of course, one of the ways was, of course, the confidence in communism and Lenin's famous quote, which was on posters all over Russia, communism will be the power of the Soviets plus electrification. Yeah. So, and in fact, the institute to electrify Russia was the first thing he set up. This is, of course, Vladimir Tatlin's, the model for the monument. The monument itself was never built, but it was intended to be far, far greater than the Eiffel Tower. And it has three solid geometric shapes in it, a sphere, a cylinder, and a cone. And on each of them, we got cinema now, because this is 1919. And so on each of them, the day's news would be projected. The latest news, a brilliant idea for 1919. I mean, we could do it so easily today. But there he is in 1919, really anticipating this whole world that we're coming into. In painting, of course, the equivalent was Vasily Kandinsky's discovery in 1911 of the possibility of making works of art that did not represent anything, but which instead used color, mass, texture, volume as the elements of works of art. And so that, of course, leads both the constructivism of Tatlin, the art that dared to be constructive in the middle of the First World War, that dared to be constructive, and of course the abstractions of Kandinsky being taught at the Bauhaus, the greatest art school of all time, and certainly of the 20th century, which taught precisely this confidence in the ability of art to change the world. And out of that, of course, came international modernism. Marcel Breuer's chair of 1928 is as fine an example as we need. Functionalism and fidelity to materials is what it's all about. This is in the Museum of Modern Art, and of course, the Museum of Modern Art is precisely the museum of the culture of transformation that was rooted in electrification. But it was a broad movement, not only modernism, but of course, the Mexican mural movement was another one of the many artistic and architectural movements that were inspired by the cultural transformation. This is Diego Rivera, a mural in which we see Frida Kahlo distributing arms to the workers on the one side, who are going to join the peasants on the other side, and it is called El Arsenal. And that mural is in the Ministry of Public Education in Mexico City. That's what it's painted for. Now, the culture of production that came with coal so relied on discipline, and the best form of discipline, discipline workforce, and the best form of discipline is self-discipline, and so it so relied on self-discipline that in the 19th century, we welcomed compulsory public education. The coal culture of production brought us public education. And by the 20th century, with the addition of the culture of transformation from electrification, we actually have the idea of using public education as a means to teach the culture of transformation, the confidence in the ability to change the world. Now, I promised that we'd just double back and look at the other side. If you remember the look on the face of Victorine Meurent in Manet's painting, and where he's trying to draw out the contrast between the human and the production process in the background, here we see that look. This is now 1895, 22 years later, in Edvard Munch's famous The Scream. And as I say in the book, we do not need to ask why she is screaming. We don't need to explain it, because we all know. We know because we're still living in that world that's very strongly affected by the coal culture of production, the anxiety about who we are in that world. And of course, this is one of the great icons of the culture of alienation. And Vincent van Gogh, of course, is another one of those icons. And really interesting thing about Vincent is that he actually tried to be a part of the culture of transformation. He was a lay preacher and a teacher who worked with the Belgian coal miners and then with the workers in the south of London. And he tried to help to change the world by working with them, and he failed. And because he failed, and we see it in his letters, he turns to his art and he expresses instead the culture of alienation. This is a very clear example of this cultural transition. Now, the alienation and the anxiety, the culture of anxiety, was not about some vague notion of not being sure about things. It was really about who we are and what kind of people we have become. The First World War, of course, was waged by those countries that had made their money out of the exercise of the culture of production, and they had the production capabilities to have death on an enormous scale. And here is Fred Varley, our great Canadian artist, member of the Group of Seven, 1919, based on his 1917 visit to the front lines. And this is painted, of course, of a scene just behind the front lines where the burials are going on. And he's asking in his title the question that everybody was asking by 1919, for what? For what? Is asking, what kind of people are we? Why did we do this collectively? And what does it mean about us that we are able to achieve this level of production, of slaughter? So the culture of anxiety is realized in the 20th century on a very large scale by the two world wars, and of course between them, the Spanish Civil War. 1937, Picasso paints the great mural Guernica, and one of the themes in it is the Weeping Woman, and this is a painting that he developed out of that theme in the mural. The mural is painted for the 1937 Paris World's Fair. So we're still with this progression of exhibitions that keep announcing to you, hey, you know what? You're a different person. Something else is happening, right? You, and the culture of anxiety, of course, is saying that you are a potential victim. And in 1937, there was actually pretty relevant advice. The Weeping Woman is weeping because of an incredible new thing that had happened in 1937. For the first time, civilians were bombarded in warfare. You have to really shout that to yourself because, gee, we're so used to it. I mean, you know, if there's a headline in tonight's paper about someplace being bombed, which there is, by the way, you turn the page. Yeah, okay, somewhere else was bombed over there. I don't know, you know. So what? In 1937, it was such big news that Guernica, the mural was done when the German Nazi and Italian fascist planes bombed the cultural capital of the Basques, Guernica. And it led to this mural and this painting. So you see, what's happening is a fantastic advance on the First World War. Even on what we thought was the total carnage that's shown in Varley's painting, now we're on somewhere else. And of course, only a couple of years later. But I mean, the remarkable thing is, there's only 8 years between the first bombing of civilians and Hiroshima, the atomic bombing. Only 8 years between them. It's amazing that we went that fast, that far, that extreme. And of course, this is Felix Nussbaum's Music for the Dance of Death. It's painted in 1944, a few weeks before Nussbaum is betrayed and captured, taken to Auschwitz, where he is murdered within a matter of weeks of this painting. And of course, it's the other side of this culture of production and the capacity for slaughter that it puts into the hands of great nation states who are making enormous wealth out of the potential of production, and of course, it is the Holocaust, which, along with Hiroshima, are the two question marks at the end of World War II that say, well, what people are we as a whole? What is humanity? What does this mean about the kind of people we are? You are a potential victim, is what the culture of anxiety tells you. Francis Bacon, of course, another one of the great iconic painters of this tradition. This is 1953 painting, and of course, only 3 years later, the first nuclear power station was opened in Britain. The first peaceful application of nuclear energy, the first energy source that came to us initially as a weapon, and a weapon of mass destruction. So, That's the culture of anxiety. Interestingly, the culture precedes the energy source. But of course, it's now so thoroughly identified with nuclear energy that you can't really have a very rational discussion with many people about nuclear energy for good reason. There are lots of good reasons. The accidents like the ones in Russia and the ones in the States, the Three Mile Island and so on, Chernobyl, certainly good reason for that. And of course, some of the fundamental issues of storage and so on that are associated with nuclear energy, no question. But it is an identification with the culture of anxiety that is really what is dominant there. Now, we've come through that same time period, during which, of course, oil and gas were gradually increasing in their importance. If we look at the Great Gatsby, 1920s, the Roaring 20s, roaring with the culture of consumption that came with oil and gas. A great many people make the error of thinking that oil and gas is just a continuation of coal, that it's sort of all the same because they're all fossil fuels. This is absolutely not true. The two cultures are absolutely contrary. Oil and gas does not depend on large numbers of disciplined workers. It is dependent on the knowledge industry of finding out where the oil is, then getting the pipeline down to it, the technology of the pipeline. If you can protect that pipeline, the value nexus moves entirely from the production end to the consumption end. So if you go to an OPEC meeting, you don't find any discussion about oil workers. Nobody really cares, because the value nexus is at the consumption end. The agenda of the OPEC meeting is how many barrels, what's the demand, and what shall be the price? That's the most important question. Okay, so the culture of consumption is what oil and gas brings to us. Andy Warhol is the genius of the culture of consumption, because of course the culture of consumption depends on everything becoming a brand. Every single thing we do. This is a brand, that's a brand, you're all wearing brands, and so on, right? The culture of consumption teaches us to see the world, the things in the world, as brands, and to a large extent, the people, such as the great luminaries that Andy paints, because they are famous. And so he has Mao, of course, he has Jackie, Liz, Marilyn, Elvis at the AGO. All these paintings rely on the brand, which is the look, the appearance of that person in their official portrait, in their official photograph, or in Jackie's case, of course, it's the famous photograph just after the assassination. And he repeats it again and again because he knows the brand will always win. The brand will come through. And he entrusts the medium of expression to the reproduction process, the screen reproduction. Let it run. And sometimes you see 14 Marilyns. Sometimes she's bright and glowing. Sometimes she's dark and looks really as if she's on her back from a funeral, or of course the whole implication of her suicide. You know, he knows that the message will come through because the brand will always win. Yeah? And it will always win in a culture of consumption, which is the culture that came to us with oil and gas. And so famously he said about Mao that he painted him because he thought he was the most famous person in the world. Perfectly good reason. By the time we get to Jeff Koons, a generation later, this is of course his puppy in front of the Museo Guggenheim Bilbao by Frank Gehry, which of course must be identified as the museum of the culture of consumption in the same way as MoMA is the museum of the culture of transformation. Okay, by the time we get to Koons and Murakami and others of this time, the culture of consumption is a received idea. It's a universally accepted idea. It's not worth discussing. Of course, Koons has just had a big retrospective in New York, and one of the real highlights was the new series. You know, in the new series, we have, for example, a new vacuum cleaner in a glass case. That is the work. Because Koons understands that the culture of consumption values more highly than anything else newness. You know, the new car smell, you know, is really what the culture of consumption is all about. But it's a received idea, and this is very, very interesting. It's a motif that goes all the way through the book. When a new energy source is just coming in, its ideas are controversial. They are, nobody's sure of them. Like right now, with renewable energy, that's what's happening. You can start a fight in any cocktail party by just saying renewable energy. And immediately, these people line up as pro, and these people are against, and you know they're off. It's easy. And the reason is that at the present time, the culture of stewardship that comes with renewable energy is still new and controversial. But when energy sources become dominant. So that's what we see, for instance, with Fitzgerald's The Great Gatsby. Fitzgerald's a moralist. He doesn't approve of the culture of consumption that he's describing in The Great Gatsby and in his other books and stories of that time, not at all. But by Warhol's time, it has become a received idea, but Warhol is one of the first to grasp it, and that's the genius of the guy. By Kuhn's time, it's a received idea. Everybody accepts it. It doesn't have to be discussed. It's just the background within which the work appears. This is Gaigo Chang of China, of course, in his 2004 piece at the Seattle Art Museum, in the foyer to the Seattle Art Museum. And of course, Gaigo Chang's medium is cars. Now, cars, of course, have to be recognized as the oil industry. Very many people talk about the automotive industry. In fact, it's simply part of the oil and gas industry. That's what makes it possible, right? So cars, of course, bring to mind Henry Ford with his great advance in the culture of consumption, which was to say that everybody could buy a car because you could all buy them on time. The whole idea of the mass automobile was a great idea that became part of the American way of life, absolutely central, and came from Henry Ford. But today, and only today, only in the last 5 or 10 years, have we started to say, well, if we extend that hypothesis to China and India, maybe it's not so good for the planet. Eh? But why not? Eh? What's wrong with Ernie Ford's idea? Eh? It is the culture of consumption which leads us to start thinking about the need for a culture of stewardship. But here, of course, it's being celebrated. Now, the other great contribution of the gasoline industry, of the car and oil industry, to the culture of consumption is in your pocket or your purse. I know I can say that confidently. Anybody raise their hand who doesn't have a credit card with them? Many of you, I just signed some books for you. Many of you bought the books with credit cards. Okay, the credit card tells us that we are all consumers. Because you see, the culture of consumption comes along and says, your relationship to the production process, just forget it. Forget all that class consciousness. You're just a consumer. You're not a change agent. You're not going to change the world. You're a consumer. Will you please just calm down and be a consumer? For 50 years now, that's what people have been told. When George Bush tried to rally people after 9/11, do anybody remember from his speech what he had to say? He said, if you want to, do you want to help America today, you should go out and shop. That's what he said. That is actually what he said. I remember being astonished by it at the time. But it's absolutely correct. W was quite intelligent. He understood that his people for 50 years have been told that their citizenship consisted in being consumers. And so they should go out and shop if they wanted to rally America. It was in the 1960s, just at the time when Warhol is at work, it's in the 1960s that oil replaced coal as the dominant energy source for the world. And so we've had 50 years of the culture of consumption. And there it is. We have 3 reproductions of Ed Burtynsky's work in the book. This is really my favorite, I guess, because it is, here it is, the culture of the car, the culture of consumption. This is what it looks like. This is the sustainability of Henry Ford's idea and of the fact of our all being consumers. And this, of course, begins, this is 1999, and this is Ed with his oil series, really at the very beginning of the conscious culture of stewardship of the earth and stewardship of the body, which is what is now incoming with renewable energy. The earth art of the past decade or two, of course, is a major example of the culture of stewardship. This is Eliasson at the Tate Modern in 2004. And of course, the Tate Modern is, this is its turbine hall. These are people in the turbine hall. And of course, the turbine hall was a power generating station, but it was no longer generating power. It was available to be used as an art museum. Why? Because of the price of oil. How's that for the culture of consumption coming home to roost? The price of oil made it impossible, and so it became an art museum, and here it is home to earth art. This is all for Eliasson, and you can see that the culture of stewardship, which is just emerging, we are just in these 20 years, in our own time, we are just seeing it now. It's going to change, it's going to grow and get greater. But one of the things about it is that it's definitely participatory, because you can see these people lying down on the floor of the turbine hall, looking up through the mist that filled the entire turbine hall at this source of energy, this source of light that Olafur Eliasson gave us. So that's a definite indication of what's happening with the culture of stewardship. Of course, architects have been quick to pick up the whole green movement and sustainable movement in architecture. This is Renzo Piano's roof of the California Academy of Sciences. And there are really two revolutionary aspects to renewable energy. One is that the building, your home, your office, your factory can become a producer as well as a consumer of energy. The two-way grid at last. The grid is not only one way, but now two-way. And you see how directly that attacks the culture of consumption. It says, no, we're not only consumers, we can also be producers. Wow, put together production and consumption, and that gives you the culture of stewardship. I wanted to, in the book, I was trying to write a formula, you know, 2 + 2 = 5. You know, it's really like that. So you can see how that's very direct. And then the other revolutionary aspect of renewable energy is that it says you can have energy without fuel. Solar and wind energy does not depend on fuel. Nothing to buy once you've installed the solar panels or the wind turbines. There is no fuel to buy. Amazing. The culture of consumption is truly under threat. This is Wang Shu, the Chinese architect who won the Pritzker Prize a year ago. This is his Ningbo History Museum of 2008, built in the Wapam style, a traditional Chinese style, in which a million bricks and tiles from old buildings are reused. And in fact, the architect did not even determine how they were to be used. He simply gave the supply of used bricks and tiles to the workers and said, put them up. Yeah? And that's what you got. Now this is a visual image that's showing you where we're going with this new culture of stewardship. And I want to just end with this image, which is from our other guest tonight. In addition to Ed, we have another, the other artist guest is from the Public Studio Group. This is a print from a show that they had over on Ossington Street O'Born, thank you. I always want to say O'Hare or something. The O'Born Contemporary on Ossington Street. They had this show, and this the upper image on this print is from. These things were actually in three dimensions in the actual exhibition, and the upper image is of a database, and it's a very thin wafer, tiny wafer, very very thin. And it is a database, right? You actually see a database. We all know we're all dependent on these databases now. What is data? I suggest in the book that data is congealed energy. You know, Karl Marx said that a commodity is congealed labor. I think what's important to grasp about data is they are congealed energy. And therefore, what they store is energy, and it's that access to energy. That's why hackers are viewed with such grave seriousness, because they are attacking the energy storage base. So it is exactly like the peasants in the Middle Ages who had terrible penalties. You know, terrible things were done to them if they were caught chopping down a tree for firewood in their master's forest. Yeah? And of course that led to the whole crisis of deforestation, which, as I point out in the book, was the world's first energy crisis, and led, of course, to coal. So it led to the underground forest of coal. So coming back then to the database, I think the culture of stewardship is going to be heavily involved with the database and so on. But what's the other image? The other oval image is an image of the sky. And we learned that it's not just any sky, it's the sky through which drones flew. Now I have to put in a plug, I'm sure she will as well, for the new piece that the Public Studio has just done. It's called Drone Wedding. If you haven't been there, go see it. It's at the Ryerson Image Center in the gallery, in the entrance of the Ryerson Image Center. And Drone Wedding, I think, is a title that I'll leave you to, she may want to explain it, but I'll leave you to conjure with. Because, remember, 1937, the first bombardment of civilians. Nobody had ever heard of such a terrible thing. And Picasso makes this great painting of outrage. 1945, the atomic bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. What does that tell us about who we are? And today, we have drones. We have brave soldiers sitting in air-conditioned places in Las Vegas, relying on databases, relying on a GPS, on all data that's come to them, and because they have control of the data, pressing a button which drops bombs on people on the other side of the world. How do you feel about that? What artist can possibly do something with that in terms of the culture of stewardship? And I'm inspired by the work that the Public Studio is doing, and I think Drone Wedding is a really exciting piece that I won't spoil by telling you about it, but do go and look, and you'll get more of a sense of it. So the culture I'm predicting, I want to just end with a prediction, the culture of stewardship of the earth and of the body. By the way, the body, I haven't mentioned, but it is, of course, about performance art. That's why performance art is so important, is it is the culture of stewardship of the body. When Marina Abramovich sits down in the gallery, in the Museum of Modern Art, and for 10 minutes she just looks you in the eye, and that's all there is. The artist is present. Her own body is the art form. Her own presence is the art form. That's coming out of the culture of stewardship of the body. Of course, at a popular level, it's the fitness industry, which has grown up in our own time, precisely because we are now aware of this need for stewardship. I'm predicting that in the next 50 years, in the next century, I spoke to another artist who is involved with the culture of stewardship, and I said, your work is going to be very much appreciated 100 years from now. And he said, I can't wait that long. Quite right. Really, I think that in our own time, this is the fundamental struggle that's going on between the culture of stewardship associated with renewable energy and the culture of consumption associated with oil and gas. And it is out of that that very, very exciting works are currently being made, including by the artists on our panel here. And the other people on the panel are also deeply involved in precisely this moment of the culture. And I can't end without one extra sentence, which is, I hope you all saw the announcement from, of all people, the Rockefellers. Rockefeller has decided to withdraw its investment in fossil fuels. Rockefeller, Standard Oil, Esso, you know? If I had predicted that, if we had this a week ago, and I stood here and said, I predict that Rockefeller will do that, you'd have all said, oh, this guy is a zealot, it's ridiculous, you know, that's not gonna happen. It's absurd, you know, but I've astounded myself. The culture of stewardship is gathering force. Renewable energy has a long way to go. It's by no means as significant as it needs to be for quite good reasons in terms of the energy industry. But as it gains force, those ideas which are now controversial will become generally received, and people will simply accept the culture of stewardship as easily as today we have accepted the culture of consumption. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Barry. not that I thought I had a really difficult job, but one of the difficult jobs I was going to have is deciding who to go first. But Elle Flanders, she was taking notes. So I think you're up first, Elle, in your thoughts and your response.
Picking on, can I say the youngest? I don't know. I might be pushing it. But so I think we just had a demonstration of what, in fact, energy is. Energy is Barry Lord and Gail. With his by his side. John introduced me by suggesting that I was going to turn this on its head by talking about cultural production as energy. So not so much the energy that goes into cultural production, but the energy that gets generated by cultural production. And I did want to say a few words about that, but Barry just said so many interesting things, and I made so many notes that I couldn't help myself, so I'm going to deviate a little bit. One of the things that I thought, Barry, that was kind of remarkable was when you talked about how you could be a change agent, you can make a change, you know, and how this is something that has been certainly a motto, I think, that I've lived by in terms of that particular, even though I realize that I'm actually in the culture of stewardship. According to the grid, I'd like to step out of the grid a little bit and say, you know, I have roots that go much further back and that I think that our art harkens back to as well, which very much comes from before cultural consumption as well, but certainly as a relationship to production and a culture of production, in which we actually believed that change was possible. And I think that some of what you talked about tonight, Barry, was uplifting in terms of the culture of stewardship, looking at it as a force of change and as a possibility. Because one of the things I wanted to mention was I was going to sort of bring up one of the things I was, you know, I guess I see what we do as sort of a collecting, a database collecting to some degree, but to another degree, I think it's also about, very much as you said, about drones and thinking about these great catastrophic moments that are before us, and as artists, what our responsibility is in the face of catastrophe and in the face of catastrophic moments. And it is not to sit idly by. It is not to just sit and sort of, you know, collect information about it and make note of it or have it in a gallery for us all to sort of, you know, consider, but hopefully to be the catalyst to thinking about what is my role in that and how can I change that? So, you know, this morning, actually, some of the big news today is, does anybody know here that we just had the largest, we had the largest gathering on climate change in a really long time, the UN, right? So the UN Summit on Climate Change, who was not at the UN's Climate on Summit Change? Do we know that? Does anybody want to give a guess? Our Prime Minister, yeah, Stephen Harper.
He was
in New York, but he wasn't actually there. And I think he's going to the dinner. And I think that this begs this question of, you know, what is the message here for us as Canadians in terms of our perpetuation of this culture of consumption right now in terms of, and Ed will address this much better, I am sure. Whether you intended to or not, I'm not sure, Ed.
I'll try.
But certainly in terms of the tar sands, certainly in terms of where we are now as a culture and what is it that we are doing or not doing in terms of the choices we make, in terms of who we vote for, an election is coming up, and in terms of how we have not become stewards of our environment here in Canada. So, you know, Naomi Klein's just come out with a great book about this where she sort of creates the connection between this and capitalism, hence, you know, culture of consumption, and how massive changes need to happen. You know, her theory is at this point is that we have to look to this as a product of capitalism. It's no longer about, you know, me complaining that we got bottles of water here and that I won't have another bottle of water, I will never drink bottles of water again. It's not just about our personal investment in, you know, I'll turn off my lights and I won't drink bottled water, but it's about changing our culture massively. And so when, Barry, you were talking about this culture of stewardship and the exchange that needs to happen and that we are part of this feedback loop perhaps, it made me think about, you know, the things that we actually physically have to do to create those changes, not just individually, but in terms of how we relate to, you know, this very country and the world around us. So I do want to get back to specifically, you know, what you were mentioning about not just drone wedding, but this piece Under the Last Sky that Tamara and I, Tamara's over here, she makes me do all the work. So this idea when we came up to it and when Barry and Gail sort of barreled through the door energetically, and he said, I'm doing this book on energy and this fits this particular aspect of what I'm doing. And you know, you sort of sit there as an artist and you think you're so clever and you think that you're really thinking about what your work is about and you're like, oh my God, I hadn't thought of that. I had no idea. So it was really revelatory to be able to start to create those connections for ourselves in terms of why was it that Tamara and I were interested in this question of silicon and databases and energy that is so present in our lives, you know, in everything from the cell phones that we use to the guy sitting in the air-conditioned little cabin and able to drop bombs in the global south and, you know, destroy hundreds of thousands of lives on a regular basis. So this was very much at the core of the work, and the database, you know, was very much partly what we were thinking about, these little silicon chips that we all use, you know, that are very much in, you know, our everyday. And then what other uses are they for these silicon chips? So that was, you know, I wanted to say, Barry, one of the things that I was thinking about in relation to that was the massive storage spaces that we are now creating, however, for these databases and the energy consumption for these little bits and bytes of information is really an astonishing thing, you know, and many of them are hidden, these databases that we cannot get to. So that's sort of another yield from this database consumption. Anyways, I just want to say congratulations, and it really created a huge energetic moment for us in terms of our production, so thank you for illuminating all of that.
Jessica, during Barry's speech, he talked about changing the world. And that's a phrase I haven't heard in a long time. The fine line between hubris and Schadenfreude is the current move towards renewable energy, one of repulsion about what we've created, or a natural development more as Barry would see it, like a natural next stage of an energy transformation. Okay, fine.
Okay. I actually have a small presentation. So bear with me, please. And Barry, I promise I'm going to give you your screen back. All right. So this is my line. Probably an adaptation of someone else's quote, but I strongly believe about it. We depend on creativity and innovation in order to make progress. So to answer your question, I just want to go back to a little bit of what I do and what I believe. So I'm here to celebrate Barry's milestone, but I'm also here representing the enablers of the culture of stewardship. And we can see the enablers here represented or reflected in the entrepreneurs that I have the privilege to work with every day. So what we see here is an entrepreneur whose dream is to develop solar energy as cheaply and affordable so the poorest communities in the poorest neighborhoods in the world can easily access that kind of resource. The second one is, those are also Canadian entrepreneurs that are trying to solve the challenge of integrating renewable energy in the grid by developing this very interesting, simple technology that consists of these giant underwater balloons that store compressed air. And then once the energy is required, they re-inject the electricity back to our electrical grid. It's a very simple idea, but not really a lot of people have come up with it. The third one is an entrepreneur that is accelerating the adoption of the smart home. And with that, he thinks that we are able to shift the conversation from we are terrible people and we, I'm quoting actually, we are terrible people and we are destroying our planet, to we can be better people because we have options that will help us to be cleaner. So these are the individuals that I have the pleasure to work with every day. So, sorry. These are cutting edge technologies that help us advance towards our energy transition. However, what I learned from Barry's book and what Barry helped me understand is that this is not enough. We need to understand what is our relationship between our energy resources, our energy transition, and our systems of values. And this is a message that Barry very clearly states for everyone that is, whether there is an innovator, whether there is a supporter, a thinker, an influencer, of the low carbon economy. If we really want to move the needle, we need to understand the systems of values that we are dealing with at this point in order to accelerate that process. So another thing that Barry helped me understand is the cultural implications that we are experiencing at this point. So we are dealing with two cultures. We are dealing with the culture of consumption with the generations that grew up under that particular mandate. They feel threatened every time that a new culture tries to undertake that process. So they feel threatened. It's not only because of their energy resources threatened. I'm also quoting you very in this case. It's because of their system of values is threatened. So this is something to keep in mind, especially for those people like me or like many people here in the audience that are trying to displace that kind of system of values to integrate a new one. So people working in the culture of stewardship are those generations that not only believe that there is a new option, that there is a new resource, but is also worried about the only planet that we have. That's a really strong value and a strong sense to have. So climate change is a defining issue of our time, and we can use art as a cultural response, whether it's by instigating a moment, just like, I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with Cave Farewell, but basically what they are trying to do is instigating this cultural change by showcasing all these provoking images of what climate change can do to our society. Or by engaging creative minds, by merging artists with scientists, with business people. And this is what myself and my team tried to do. Last month we had a show called, a show mounted by our new program. This is a Mars initiative called Adjacent Possibilities in Art and Energy. And what we try to do here is we try to showcase solutions to the big problem. So we got tired of scaring people away. Instead of that, we really strongly believe that there is amazing Canadian innovation in this country, and they represent a solution, and also they align with the culture of stewardship that Barry describes. So just as he mentions, I'm very, very excited to see what artists are going to develop as a result of this culture of stewardship. So I want to conclude by inviting you to do two things. If you really feel inspired by this wonderful talk and by all these wonderful panelists, I'm very honored to join today. The first invitation is to read Barry's book. So, And what Barry does here is really, he's challenging us. So he's saying, when you're really told that your values, your beliefs, what your attitude came from was from your upbringing and from your life experience, well, what happens if we add an extra layer of complexity? And this is really the energy resources that we depend and that we are in touch with. The second one is that if you got tired of living in the valley of consumerism, I invite you to join the initiatives that are taking place in your city, whether they are advocacy initiatives, or they are art initiatives, or they are business initiatives. I invite you to join this community because we are not alone. This community is growing and growing even more. And I also invite you to join the initiatives that are taking place in the world. All these initiatives, what they are doing is promoting this culture that Barry describes in his book as a culture of consciousness and awareness. Let's wake up. So the thing is that I work with energy resources. I believe that they are a solution, but they are not all the solutions. While they become mature and they become available so we can transition to this new energy resource, we can speed up the day that this new culture happen, when this new culture happen. So this solution is not only on the technology. This solution also relies on our consumption habits, of our conservation practices, as well as our social and our political leadership. So I guess that somehow answered your question. I invite you to talk more about this culture of stewardship, and thank you very much. Congratulations, Barry.
So I think maybe it's time for a little change of pace. And Jeff Melanson's just come here from Alberta. Do they see things differently there, Jeff?
Not at all, John.
Okay.
I don't think I'll quite answer that, just because we are videotaping this. But I did draw out some notes. I did get to spend some good time. Actually, before I do that, for any of you that thought tonight was a mayoral debate, I'm really, really sorry. And just trust me, my transit plan is the right one for you. In terms of our value systems, I got to spend a fair bit of time with some elders in the Siksika community in Alberta, which are part of Treaty 7 territory. And one of them, Elder Tom Cranebear, I got to spend a particularly significant amount of time with. And he would ask, whenever we would talk about the state of the world and so on, why? And trying to explain to a really profound, thoughtful elder why we do what we do or why we're in this place is tough. And you know, his view was really that building understanding and trying to understand what the fundamentals are that got us here is really critical. So for me, rather than sort of vilifying anybody or speaking about polarization just off the start, I may start with human energy. And so my career I've spent in the arts education, arts training incubation space, which is really about the energy, the creative potential that we all have embedded within us, whether we like to acknowledge it or not. The first energy source we're probably aware of or we're fueled by is our heart. And in fact, most of our artistic practice is really connected fundamentally to what we all have within us. Dancers are connected to our physical movement. We speak on pitch. In fact, John Cage did a number of experiments to try to get away from sound. And as long as we're alive, our body is emitting a pulse and a pitch. So for us, it really is about, in the arts, trying to flip the paradigm a little bit away from this aesthetic divide, which tells you as an audience that we're artists and your job is to buy our stuff and trust us it's good, and more towards creating awareness of that fundamental creative potential within you all. So when I first arrived in Banff, this was my sort of very Pollyanna-ish view of the world, which I retain to this day. And I was approached by a man named Harvey Locke, who some of you probably know, who's quite a renowned environmentalist in Canada. And he and a couple of others in Banff started referring to me as Mr. Toronto, because I'd moved from downtown Toronto to Banff and hadn't really experienced the many wonders of Banff National Park. For any of you that haven't been, you really should go, and into many of the other great national parks in the country. So we went out, and he taught me a whole pile of things I didn't know one day, and we stopped at the end. It sounds like we were on a date. We were not. We stopped at a lodge, had a glass of wine, and he said, what are you about? And I said, you know, for me, when I look at art history, there's a period where we created this notion of aesthetics, which really separated art from people. And really what art is, in my mind, is really our attempts to create meaning, to create purpose within our lives, and the more connected artistic practice is to our audience, to ourselves, the better. And as we were talking about this, he started talking about, in his mind, the Cartesian divide, which he described to me, and I'm sorry, I'm sure there are people on the scholarship side who can explain this better than I can. But there was a period of human history where our narrative really was about the natural world. Within that natural world was human society, which is this wonderfully dysfunctional, beautiful, fraught thing we've created. And within that was a small circle called the economy, which was something that we used as a facilitating tool to work within human society, within the natural world, which gives us all life. And how at some point, right around the time we created the notion of the aesthetic divide, we also created this divide that reordered that, where somehow we as human beings removed ourselves from that natural order. And as we were talking about this, we sort of found a bit of a kinship between artistic practice and how it needs to adapt and some of the environmental movement principles, which I thought were pretty interesting. As John referenced, one of the other challenges in Banff is at the Banff Center, we had 4,000 artists through the center every year who have a particular, how to put it, a fairly homogenous political persuasion. We're funded by a province that has a different political persuasion and many donors who might share that as well. And what we found, what I found in interacting with all of these people was within all of us is a fundamental willingness, desire to create meaning and to do something good for the earth while we are here. And yet somehow we have created discourse that is very polarized. So in addition to removing human beings from an artistic or natural process, we've also created structures that really create vilification of both sides. And what we found often at Banff was the environmental community not willing to speak to the business community, and the artistic community is off doing its own thing. And I think writ large, that is what I observed when I lived in Toronto for 10 years, was we have all of these wonderful, wonderful communities that do not know how to speak to each other in a way that is not threatening, that is a way that is connected through human meaning and trying to create something better. So I think one of the fundamental assumptions I just want to sort of highlight on, I know I'm sort of bouncing around a little bit, trying to respond to Barry's breadth and diversity, is this notion that the sort of consumptive model or economics is sort of the primary driver of human behavior. And what I mean by that is within the arts community, and I'm 2 weeks into the Toronto Symphony Orchestra job, for any of you who haven't subscribed, it's not too late. We make decisions based on economics. Like almost before we come up with a really cool idea artistically, we're already assessing whether or not we can make it profitable or whether we can make it break even. And that is a terrible, terrible way to think about creative practice. And in fact, in public school education, in colleges and universities, having that embedded fundamental economic assumption, where again, economics was a tool, not the sort of meaning and purpose of our lives, we have to be very careful of. So, what I would encourage my artistic colleagues to do is think more broadly about hope and potential and impossibility. What I encourage us all to do is ensure that the conversations we're facilitating that are important to us really do stretch across different sectors much more effectively than we have. I think the current political discourse in our country is very disheartening on all sides. I think economically speaking, we're a very siloed country, we're a very siloed city, and we need to break through that to really create meaning and purpose. And I want to thank Barry and congratulate him on the book, and also encourage you all to buy it, and again, subscribe to the Toronto Symphony Orchestra. Thank you very much.
I'm just going to shut this down to Ed. You haven't done Ed yet? They're perfect. Ed, your pictures have spoken volumes. If Barry could write 3 more books, he would only sort of get close to what you have done on this subject. Your thoughts?
Well, I could probably use Barry's title, except instead of Art and Energy, is Energy as Art. So I may borrow your title. But that's what I've been photographing, this notion that, what I found is Barry did effectively do a run through all of human history to kind of give a positioning of how we used energy. And I found that, I wish I had that book 30 years ago when I began this venture, because I would have seen things a little differently, I think. It never occurred to me at that time, but what I found interesting is that when we first kind of emerged, it was like physical energy, and then when we got our tools, it was physical material energy, you know, and then copper, stones, you know, making weapons and basic things. But it was only when we got to the point where we started farming that we had excess calories, and then the social political systems came into place with that extra energy that we had from grain storage, and then the management of that storage, and then once that happened, aesthetic culture arrived as well. The ability for people not to have to work in the field, but to sit outside of society and begin to reflect back on it. So we got our writers and our painters and our architects, and so culture began to become something. And when I look at what I'm doing, I'm really in the material culture and the aesthetic culture. And what I'm trying to do within this kind of capitalist consumer envelope that I'm living in is to take something that even I started taking for granted every day. I get in my car, or I'm in my home, I flip a switch, I get electricity, I fill up my tank and all the oil derivatives, and I recognize that we've totally lost connection with where all this material is coming from. And that the fact that the Stone Age and the Iron Age and the Copper Age and all these ages are alive and well and functioning on a level that's frightening. And I thought, well, what better tool, in a way, is to go in to those ancient ages, which are still present, and capture the scale. And we've always taken from nature. So if you went to a medieval town before the internal combustion engine and you looked at that town, most of the materials would have arrived within what an ox and a cart could drag over. If you're on land, if we look at what we build today, we may be getting stone from China, we may be getting wood from South America. So we have no connection now to the materials that we use on a daily basis, and we're all implicated, including myself. So ultimately, what your book chronicles and what I've also tried to mirror as well is how do these how do we reconnect? How do we begin to understand that something has changed? So that in the past, when we were a smaller community of, when I was born, there was 2.5 billion people, and there's 7 billion people today. So what's changing in that six decades, it's almost a billion people per decade is adding to the human population. And with that comes speed and scale. And what I've recognized in doing it, and I had my energy epiphany when I was looking at all these mines and quarries and realizing that the only way we can work at that scale is, a cheap energy source, oil, and the internal combustion engine brought together allowed us to be able to mine and move and create ships and move, rocks from China to here to build with and make it even viable. So that, to me, was a real moment where going back and looking at all these large-scale things, I started thinking, I've never gone and seen where our oil comes from, and I went to those landscapes and tried to bring them into kind of collective consciousness as well through the work, through the photograph, which I felt was really the perfect vehicle to begin to describe, scale, because it's something that we still inherently believe as a chemical optical, image on a sheet of paper, that there's still a place that exists in the world that looks like that. And I've been careful not to kind of go into Photoshop in a way and create those worlds, but to say, no, this world actually exists. This scale is actually there. And then when with this picture behind, I thought, it occurred to me that one of the largest things that we as humans produce, the single largest thing we produce is waste. So I began looking at waste and the stream of waste, which this image is one of, because it is a byproduct of consumer capitalism, is that we create, if we don't have this huge stream of waste happening, we're not buying new things. And this constant, the iPhone and Apple is a perfect example. Every 2-3 years, you need a new phone because you're left behind. The plug doesn't work, you can't run your programs, whatever. But that's, we've developed a culture where the waste stream is the largest movement of material that we've created on the planet. So, and I do encourage the audience to, it's a very readable book. It's really, well defined. And at first I didn't, the connection, I think is that really art and energy? And I've been working in that, and I really, but when you kind of look at and start reading it, it certainly made complete sense to me. So thanks for bringing the book into the world.
And a hand to all our panelists, really, for adding immeasurably to Barry's presentation. We have time, a little bit of time, for any questions. If anybody has a question, there's supposed to be a handheld microphone. Here it comes now. There we go. Does anybody have a question? Yes.
I'd like to ask you, you have emphasized change and changes in energy source and resulting changes in values and society. I'd be interested to hear what you might think about continuity, because Al was talking about wanting to hold on to the idea that I can change everything, and some of the other speakers have spoken about some of the things that are being carried forward. And if it's the case that one thing supersedes another, maybe the things from the past don't actually disappear to the extent that that sounds. So could you say something about the role of persistence?
It's a good question. Is this on?
Yeah, it's on.
It's a good question. I did mention in my talk that every energy source, as long as we're still using that source of energy, the cultural values that come with it are still with us. So if you look at the first six chapters, which I didn't talk about tonight, if you look at the first six chapters, you know, the mastery of fire gives you the culture of the hearth, which is the culture of community, the basic thing that makes us human. The culture of the energy source of cooperation, which soon becomes control, of controlled labor, but cooperation, which is, of course, with so much, we're so much more effective with our energy if we cooperate as opposed to doing it singly. That gives us a culture of collective identity. It's still very, very much with us, for better and worse. There are good things about it and there's bad things about it, but it's still very much there. And so on through. Animal power is still very important in many parts of the world. Not so important here, perhaps, but in many parts of the world, animal power is still very important. And with it, of course, came domestication. I quote the archaeologist, Ian Hodder, who said, before we could domesticate, we had ourselves first to be domestic. Domesticity. The culture of domesticity came with animal power. You know, we couldn't get animal power without first being domestic, abandoning our life as hunters and gatherers, and instead becoming domestic. So what I'm saying, and I could go on, but I won't. each of the ancient sources, you still have continuity by all means. They're still here. They're still with us. Even the culture of domination that came with slavery is still with us very much. And not only in places where slaves are held, but you know, throughout the whole world, the culture of domination, male-female relationships and parent-child relationships and so on. You know, that is still very much with us. For better and worse, we have continuity of all those things as well as the cultural change. And what's happening today will not remove the culture of consumption, of course, from the world. You know, there's always been consumption, but it will change it with the cutting edge. It's very much like cutting edge in art. Just as we have a cutting edge in art, so we have a cutting edge in energy sources. And right now, that's with renewable energy and the culture of stewardship that comes with it. But continuity, you're quite right. There is continuity of all those as well. That's why we have as complex and interesting an energy debate as we do right now.
Thank you. Next, anybody? Panel? All right. Is there?
No.
No, I think she's just.
Okay. She's a mic.
Oh, she is the mic. Thank you. Thanks, Ed.
Well, I think then we will wrap it up. I want to thank the panel for their fascinating riffs, if I may use that jazz term, on Barry's book. The author, of course, Barry Lord, the author of Art and Energy. And Barry will be downstairs. I know many of you will want to talk to him, but he's actually going to be downstairs signing books. And so thank you for a fabulous evening, and thanks again to the Gardiner, our host.
Would you please?